Are the mutants of Krakoa set for religious enlightenment or damnation? Let's hop into the pages of Way of X issue number 1 from Cy Spurrier and find out together, shall we? So then, as we join this newest X-Men book, Professor X is awoken in the night with a horrible vision of some strange patchwork man standing over him. More on this in a minute. Feeling truly rattled and looking for a sympathetic ear, Chuck decides to psychically check on in with Nightcrawler. Kirk Wagner, you'll know from reading the other X-Men books, had been quite reserved in this new age of Krakoa, going through a lot of real crises of faith brought on by Krakoa and its new post-death mutant society. It's for all those reasons and more, Xavier is actually excited to see Nightcrawler get back out in the field. Currently, the Jolly Blue Elf is leading a team of younger mutants on a covert mission in Vatican City. It would seem that Orchis, the evil mutant-hating organization with its tentacles in a bunch of other different organizations, has of recently been dumping a ton of money and resources into one of the holiest cities in the world in an attempt to try and recruit a brand new generation of mutant-hating anti-Krakoan Vatican style missionaries. Why, just to really hit home how much they don't like mutant kind, they've developed an entire museum dedicated to some of the worst, darkest moments from mutant history. All in all, these black and white collared dudes aren't too hard to take down. In fact, Pixie decides to have a little fun with them by sending them on a groovy trip with her pixie dust. Nightcrawler fully admits there's a lot of this new younger mutant generation that he doesn't quite understand, and some that even alarms him, like their flippant relationship with death. In fact, when the other mutants actively make fun of Pixie for having not popped her death cherry just yet, she decides to really guilt these anti-mutant missionaries by purposefully walking into a shotgun blast just to really show them how serious this situation is. And again, none of Nightcrawler's team are fazed by this at all. In fact, they think the whole thing is kinda funny and kinda cool, which is admittedly pretty alarming. Now back on Krakoa, Nightcrawler decides to play a little practical joke on the Master of Magnetism himself by setting up one of those statues from the Mutant Hate Museum. This one actually marking Magneto's first appearance when he tried to use his magnetic powers to steal a bunch of human missiles before eventually getting stopped by the young X-Men. Leave it to Eric, though, to not actually go along with a good joke and instead use this as an excuse to evangelize and proselytize to the other mutants about the greatness of Krakoa. Magneto also goes in on Kirk too, saying, "Hey, didn't Cyclops tell me you were going to create a brand new mutant religion? Why are you slacking on that? We should have had that on our desk already." Nightcrawler admits that while he was gung-ho at the idea of creating a brand new faith, every time he put pen to paper, he just, well, couldn't exactly think of what a moral doctrine for a post-mortality society should look like. And because, you know, Kirk is just a regular old person and not a complete and utter egomaniac like Magneto, he didn't even think he himself should be the sort of person to tell other people how to live their lives. That's still not to say, though, that Kirk positively loves everything that's going on in Krakoa. For one, he absolutely hates the whole crucible thing that they do on the island to decide who should be resurrected and who should get their lost powers back. In fact, he's having such a philosophical crisis, he ends up being short with a woman who claims to be lost and is asking for his help. But more on that later. It's while staking out the Crucible, Nightcrawler ends up bumping into, get this, Dr. Nemesis. I know there's been a few Dr. Nemesises, and I'm not exactly sure which one this is, but all you need to know is Dr. Nemesis is a super genius who's actually been helping out the mutants with all their brand new scientific and medical advancements as of recently. Nemesis also kind of serves as the perfect foil for Nightcrawler in this story. After all, Kirk is very faithful and very pious, but Nemesis, he's a man of science and logic and reason. For the life of him, Nemesis just can't understand why someone like Nightcrawler, who has traveled to space, traveled in time, seen the gods of other pantheons, is still so faithful to a Christ god that he can't see. It's true these guys don't have a lot in common, but they do actually have one particular thing that they do agree on, and that is they don't like the Crucible and how barbaric and cruel it is. In fact, hey, speaking of which, remember that lost woman from before? Well, she wasn't lost, her name is Lost, and she was actually trying to ask Nightcrawler for help in the Crucible. After all, he's a kind one. He would end her life quickly and uncruelly and allow her to be resurrected with her powers. Unlike Magneto, though, who very much is the spiritual successor to Apocalypse's whole survival of the fittest ideology. He's gonna fight her, he's gonna make it hurt, and he's gonna make sure that only the people truly deserving of resurrection and the return returned powers get it. In fact, that's what Nemesis brings up too. That the Krakoans, whether they knew it or not, are actually taking part in a brand new evolutionary mechanism by making sure only those who die in the Crucible, aka die glorious, brutal deaths, can jump the line of resurrection, while everyone else who's not willing to die has to wait it out. Basically, the Crucible is making it so Krakoan society is dominated by the most combat-focused, zealous mutants of them all. And much to Nightcrawler's horror, the younger generation of mutants are positively eating this Crucible blood sport up. Now, Nightcrawler and Nemesis go to the hatchery as Pixie is being reborn later that day. It's also at the same time, too, Professor Xavier is finally able to open up to Nightcrawler about what scared him before. You see, apparently the children of Krakoa have been sharing their own unique boogeyman story recently. No, not the one they've been trying to feed them about the evils of the Great Pretender, the Scarlet Witch. No, some other evil force called the Patchman. A mysterious ghostly being that feeds on nightmares and bad emotions and that people only ever seem to see after their resurrection, like Pixie. Professor X doesn't believe that there's anything paranormal about this story, but that there probably is some powerful, confused, maybe sick mutant out there, and that Nightcrawler would be the perfect person to help them because, well, after all, Kirk is the nicest, kindliest, most welcoming mutant that Xavier knows. Nightcrawler agrees to take the case, and later that night he decides to go for a walk in the graveyard, where he hears a rather mysterious voice questioning how Krakoa is run, and why it always seems that the precogs, those who see the future, always end up getting pushed further and further down the list for resurrection, almost as if Krakoa is trying to hide something. Turns out that voice belongs to David Haller, aka Legion, aka Charles Xavier's nigh-omnipotent reality warping multiple personality having son. And so that was Way of X issue number one, everybody, and as with most of these brand new X-Men books, this first issue was an absolutely stacked one. This series looks like it plans to ask a lot of very interesting, very deep, and very complex questions about faith, belief, God, the afterlife, and a universe that's filled with so many amazing things. And I mean, really, what better character to explore all of these different, very complex ideas than with Nightcrawler? More than anything, I think what I really appreciate about this book is that it actually kind of offers up an alternate take on Krakoa and everything they're doing, where most of the other X-Men books have been very rah-rah in favor of the nation. This one actually has some harsh criticism in-universe for what's going on. If the series can continue to be this intellectually stimulating, I think we're going to be in for one hell of a comic book ride. I would give this one a much-deserved 8.5 out of 10.
Hey there, everyone. It's your old pal, Cave Jewel, and if you're seeing me right now, that means you watched to the end of the video, which I am very appreciative of. It really helps drive engagement and retention and all that other good YouTube stuff. So does liking and commenting. Wink, wink. If you like my content, too, you should check out my Patreon page. We just redid all the tiers, so there's a ton of great rewards. You can become a patron for as little as a dollar a month, and, well, it would just really help me out. It's never expected, but always appreciated. So until next time, everyone, I've been Cape Joel, and I will see you next time. Bye-bye.